Welcome to first edition of Speak Art. Today we will be discussing two very important artists from two parts of the world who actually are more than artists, they are icons of feminist art movement around the world.
Extraordinary artists, women artists that we'll be talking about today are Amrita Sher Gil and Frida Kahlo. And these two artists have not only had extraordinary lives, they painted some really amazing work in a very short span of time.
So both of them were contemporary to each other. Frida was born in Mexico. Amrita Sher Gil was born in Budapest in Hungary. Amrita is about 6 years younger to Frida Kahlo. I'm talking about the early 20th century. So 1907 is when Frida Kahlo was born, and Amrita Sher Gil was born in 1913 in Hungary. But their lives have so much parallel to each other that it's difficult to not believe that they were not soul sisters. Even their work, the topics, the subjects that they have picked up are very similar to each other.
The beautiful obsession that they have with themselves, almost a narcissistic style of work that they had in the self-portraits, is amazing thing to see. And you'll see, when you'll see the portraits that they both have painted, you'll see the nudes that they have painted of themselves, you'll see a lot of similarities between the styles and the colors, especially the colors also of these two women artists.
So their art learning, so to say, that they the inspirations have similar roots. Frida Kahlo also started emulating and learning from European artists, and Amrita Sher Gil also went to study in France, in Paris, and she also began her career by getting inspired from a lot of European art. So European art was very influential at that time, and there was very little art coming out from South America or this part of Asia at that time. So they began their learning of art by copying these great European masters.
And then eventually in their journey, they found their own roots. And that's what Amrita did. She came back to India when she was told that, you know, her art and the colors resonate the East, and she should travel to East, find her own roots. And similar thing happened with Frida when she discovered her own culture and rediscovered her own culture. And she started painting a lot of stuff about and on the themes of Mexico.
So let's talk about their art style a little bit. The learning of art, as we were saying earlier, began from the European masters. They copied a lot of European art. But then there came a very interesting moment in both of these artists' life that helped them discover their true identity.
So in Amrita's life, what happened is when she was in Paris, and she was very much, you know, working in these bohemian artist circles, and she was winning awards, European awards and all those things. And her professors pointed out that her colors and her visual style belonged to the East, and it did not have much of a sensibility of the West. And that is the point where she also realized that she doesn't find the European palette so interesting.
Very interestingly, Amrita Sher Gil said that the Europe belongs to Picasso and Matisse, and India belongs to only me. And that's when she came back to India. And after coming back to India, she moved in to Shimla.
Shimla, yes.
And there she began to experiment with a lot of Indian palette. That time in India, the Bengal school of art was at the peak, and the styles of Rabindranath Tagore and Jomini Rai was very popular. And Amrita picked up some of her inspiration from these great Indian artists as well.
And also, she became a contemporary in that because the themes that they were already painting were mythological. The women that were painted, Raja Ravi Verma and all that were... Not Raja Ravi Verma, right? Right. So the women that were painted by Gemini Roy and you know, such artists were mythological in nature, and she picked up ordinary women, you know, contemporary women with desires and dreams and hopes.
It's only when she was asked to go and discover herself around India by traveling to various parts of the country by her then friend cum lover was a journalist and
she encouraged her.
He encouraged her to travel and discover the true identity that lies in her culture. That took her to south of India, where she discovered the great Ajanta Ellora caves, and that inspired her work furthermore. It's during that time in south India that she painted one of her great masterpieces.
The Bride's Toilet, The Brahmacharis, The Elephant, all these paintings came out of that genre that she was working with that time. And those paintings are, they depict really dark-skinned people, a certain melancholy in them, which wasn't really present in the European style that she was painting earlier. The colors became very vibrant and very earthy.
So there was a great shift from the perspective on Indian life and Indian art. She painted a lot of her subjects were mostly villagers, the life in the village, and women in the village specifically that she was painting, and that subjects really brought soul to her work.
And her real exploration later, the large body of work that she left came from the villages of Punjab. When she started traveling and started finding her own roots, you know, she had a Sikh father, and she started traveling to Punjab, and that's where she realized the contrast, the striking contrast of the lives of women, you know, the life that she lived at that particular age of being 15 and 16, and the life that these young girls were living. She saw this hopelessness in them, a certain melancholy where they did not know, they were not able to express their sexuality freely, which she, Amrita, did very well, you know. Yeah. Even while 15 or being 15 or 16, very early ages, you know, she experimented with a lot of lovers. She was bisexual, she had women and men both as her lovers.
So this theory and this perception of pain and conformity of Indian women is can be seen in her painting called Three Sisters,
yes.
Which is actually Amrita's her own
cousins
who were getting married. They were part of an arranged marriage system, and for Amrita, she wanted to capture the expressions on their eyes, and it's a beautiful painting right now available at National Gallery of Modern Art
another
in Delhi.
Painting that shows this longing and this sexual desire of women is the afternoon siesta, where a newlywed bride is lying on a charpoy in a very suggestive pose with her mother-in-law kind of on her bedside, you know, which kind of shows the longing of a woman for the sexual touch of a man with sans the man, you know. And that was the state of women at that time. Men were traveling, going to the cities to work, and women were like there, you know.
This deprivation of sexuality and connection, which was broken by the economic needs of the families in those times, the villages, were very beautifully captured by Amrita Sher Gil in her paintings. And most of her work at the later stage went much deeper into this whole melancholy and this longing phase of Indian village women who were suffering because men had to be out of the house and they have to take care of the entire house and also themselves.
And
as well.
But still suffering from patriarchy, you know, which was like so deep rooted in that pre-partition culture of ours, you know.
Yeah. And comparing that to the contemporary, her contemporary Frida. Frida also went through a similar journey of discovering her true self-identity. She, for a very long time, remained under the shadows of Diego Rivera, who was her husband at that time. And wherever she will go, she will introduce herself as a wife of the ego. Yeah. It's only that when they moved to United States of America, to San Francisco in 1930s, it was a period for Frida to, it was a very productive period for Frida, and she did a lot of work there. But at the same time, she did not like the whole capitalist culture of USA, and she was quite annoyed with Diego, and finally forced him to come back to Mexico with her. He wasn't very happy with her whole concept of coming back to Mexico, but he followed her for his relationship. And eventually, when she came back to Mexico, is then when she began to experiment and bring elements of Mexican folk culture and folk art into her paintings. And that's when her painting began to differentiate from what she was doing earlier, which was much more European style. By the late 1930s, by 1939, she and Diego came to a point of divorce, and it's after the divorce she painted her famous painting Two Fridas, where you can see one Frida as dressed up in a European dress, and another one in a typical traditional Mexican dress. And then you notice the symbolisms between in the painting between the two women as well, where the European woman is holding a scissor in her hand close to her vagina, and there it symbolizes sort of a you know, patriarchal cutoff of feminine energy. You know, the scissors represent that, and there's blood all over that dress. On the parallel, there is the traditional Frida dressed up in a traditional dress as well, and both of these women are connected through veins of blood. Their hearts are connected through this vein of blood. The Mexican Frida holds a miniature portrait of Diego, her husband, and the European Frida had one part of her body missing, which is you know, the sort of absence of the lover after the divorce she experienced, and that marked a very strong sense of Frida's identity after that. And once she was divorced from Diego, she became economically independent, and she decided to never borrow money from him for any of her life anymore. And then she cut her hair short, and which was a very big thing in those times for women to cut her hair, and that's why she followed and did a lot of act of non-conformist act as a female artist. Later in her life, when her art became much more powerful based on these elements of Mexican tradition, you can see the same thing happening in one of her famous self-portrait, where she has a black bird as a part of her necklace, which in Mexican culture represents hope. On one side of her shoulder is a black cat, which represents death at the same time. So two extreme perspectives that she was struggling with in her life as well. And that's what brought her her true identity, and her color palette became much more folkish in nature as well. There are some elements of Aztec mythologies that she used in her paintings at the later time. So the subject also became very localized, and that brought her her true purpose in life, which is to record the Mexican culture and the Mexican life, very similar to what Amrita was doing, recording the true Indian village life through her painting, and that was her purpose.
So it brings us to this very interesting conclusion and very interesting perspective, that both these women were looking for their true identities, you know, and that was like one of the struggles that they had, and it is very common between both of them, you know, struggling with the identities at first and then finally discovering who they were and their roots.
And as life moved on of their things, when they reached to the to almost the peak of their careers, both the women lived a great life, but in a very short span of time. Amrita Sher Gil's life was actually much shorter than Frida Kahlo's. Both the women suffered a great deal of feminine experiences. Both of them went through two abortions in their life, which was a great deal of strain on their bodies as well. But Frida actually suffered a much deeper physical pain all through her life. At the age of 6, she suffered with polio. At the age of 18, she met with a very critical accident in a bus she was traveling with, which left her in bed for 3 months. And it's that time when she actually discovered her talent for art. Later in her life, she had abortions, as I mentioned earlier. And by almost the end of her life, she also had to go through gangrene in one of her legs, and which had to be cut off. A part of her leg had to be cut off. Her entire life she suffered through a back pain, and she had multiple surgeries in her back as well. While all that physical pain was going on, she also suffered the biggest loss of being a female, that is that she could not bear children, and she remained childless all through her life.
So Sundeep is talking about the physical pain, and I want to talk about the psychological pain that both these women went through. So both these women were lovers at heart, and they were like these very adventurous women who experimented a lot with love, and who didn't care much about the society and how the society felt about them. And they had multiple lovers, both men and women. And one of the very interesting things that they both suffered throughout is heartbreaks. And that is the psychological pain that also reflects in their art. And both these women struggled with the finding love and staying in love. And then moving on in love, and that's very interesting similarity that these both women had.
So Amrita Sher Gil went through many affairs in her life, from one lover to another lover, and that shows that the kind of melancholy she must have suffered after every heartbreak that she went through, which flows into her work as well. Eventually she married the same doctor who was her cousin as well, and Dr. Victor, who actually helped her had abortions before marriage as well, and eventually she remained married to him by the end, until the end of her life as well. Parallelly, Frida, who fell in love with Diego when she was 16 years old, who was 20 years elder to her, married him, but then they had to suffer a divorce after the marriage, and finally after 1 year she married him back as well. So she married the same man twice, but during this long period of thing she also had a lot of affairs with multiple men and women, and Frida's lover that she was truly in love with when she was going through this troublesome time with Diego, who was in New York, refused to marry her, and he said that he's in love with somebody else and planning to marry her as well. And when she returned back from that experience, Diego asked for a divorce from her, and that kind of
double yammy
that kind of broke her. And she said, she very famously said that I have had two great accidents in my life, one which I had at the age of 18 in the bus, and second is Diego. And that's the kind of statement they had. But besides the personal life and the suffering that that you can see in their paintings and artworks, and you know, the pain, the terror, the horror, the suffering that both these women reflected in their paintings as well, they were completely non-conformists. Their lifestyle was absolutely different than the norms of the women and the society had at that time. In many parts of the world, the women were not allowed to even vote. In India, women, which was a very strong patriarchal society, women were not supposed to choose even her husband, while Amrita Sher Gil was experimenting with many lovers, and not just men but also women as well.
So both these women were ready to experiment with the body to reach to a person's mind, and that was very interesting. The intellectual pursuit was so high that the body itself did not matter, and that is very much reflected in their work also.
Yes, and why these women are we talking about after so many years of their death as well, and why they are important for our life today? Both of these women, their work wasn't really popular during their lifetime so much. It's only at the end of their life and mostly after the death that their work that they produced was used as a symbol for certain kind of movements. Frida Kahlo became a very powerful symbol for feminist art movement and feminist movement in the 70s and LGBT movement in the 80s because of her her lifestyle, because of experimenting with men and women. She was bisexual, but at the same time she also lived life on her own terms. Similarly, Amrita Sher Gil also her life story is so powerful behind the artwork that it inspired a lot of people after her death as well. And she became one of the most iconic feminine artists of India, which was a space which was in vacuum at that time.
Interestingly, Amrita Sher Gil was called the Frida Kahlo of India, and that's so amazing, you know.
Yeah, so that's because the similarities in their life and in their artwork and their philosophy and perspective on life was so much equal to each other that you can almost call them soul sisters of that time.
And interestingly, not just the work, and if you look at their portraits, the pictures that they have clicked of themselves, you can find that vibe, that look, you know, that both these women share, which is so interesting, you know.
Yeah.
They had similar vibes, similar
they had the same qualities. Yeah, they had the same soul burning inside those bodies, and I think that similarity is very visible in both of their lifestyle, their work and everything. Frida Kahlo became a great icon by the late 80s and 90s, and it is said that her face is as iconic as Che Guevara's face. Yeah. In today's pop culture as well. And Amrita Sher Gil, on the other hand, has become an iconic Indian female artist, where every coming female artist after that had to match that benchmark of Amrita Sher Gil's work.
So well. Interestingly, both these women shared a passion for writing as well. Amrita Sher Gil is really renowned for her letters that she wrote to her family, her mother, which recently have been published in a book. There's poetry written by her, which is beautiful in every sense, and same goes for Frida Kahlo. Whenever she was not painting, she was writing, and her work in fact as a writer itself is very beautiful.
Yeah, both these women were very avid readers.
Yeah.
And very great at expressing their identity and their opinions on the world as well, and that's why they had a breakthrough in cheerleading this movement of feminist movement that you're experiencing today. If you look at the life of these two women, they provide you a great archetype of feminist movement even for the current times that we're living in right now. So besides being great artists, both these women, they also participated very closely to the political movements of their country. Amrita Sher Gil was from a very elite class. Her family belonged to a very elite class, so she had very close ties with the Congress Party at that time. And it is said that a lot of her melancholy paintings of the villagers were used by Congress as a propaganda paintings as well. While parallelly, Frida Kahlo was a much more active participant in the communist movement that was going on in Mexico at that time. And in most of her paintings, the later paintings, she painted Lenin and the communist symbol in a lot of her artwork as well. And she very actively participated in demonstrations and protest in her country as well. So not they were just artist painting stuff, but they lived the subjects and the concepts that they were painting in their paintings as well. And that's what makes them and their story so powerful to be told and retold, where art eventually rises to the point of symbolism, of representing something and not just beauty. At the same time, imagine the time when Amrita Sher Gil and Frida Kahlo lived in 1920s and 30s, when the voting rights were not given to women. The societies were so patriarchal that women were not supposed to really participate in great decision making or step out and follow the commands of the elders of the society. A lot of society and a lot of part of society, still the practice is followed. And in those times, Amrita Sher Gil was free to choose her lovers, and she had many lovers, not just men and women. And this whole concept of LGBT that we talk about right now is these people lived those lives in those times when you can imagine how difficult it could have been for them to come out with those parts of their life as well. Frida Kahlo also had some great lovers, men and women, both of them, and the multiple lovers that they had in their life, you know, so that makes them the true icons of LGBT movement as well, at the same time.